I would like to show you a little something extra that I'm working on for the fall semester to give you a sneak preview and to make sure that I can get it working. I won't subject you to it as part of your homework, so if you do need to go, and feel free, but this will probably take about 10 to 15 more minutes if you're interested. PowerPivot is a very powerful way, hence the name. It used to be an extra add-in that you had to download, but as Microsoft has decided to use Excel as its main tool to tap into large data sets, they had to build in some extra functionality to be able to work with large data sets. You'll notice that spreadsheet that we started out with, that Access database, was just one table of data. It's like 15 columns wide by 60 some odd thousand rows deep. Rarely when you go to tap into a company's data is all the table nicely built and constructed for you in one table. More often than not, it's stored in what's referred to as a relational database. Now, I'm not going to teach you relational database design as part of this class, but almost always a company's data is stored in a relational database. And if you're in a position where you're asked to, hey, go into the database and extract this out, you're going to need to either A, figure out how to extract the data out of the existing relational database, or if you can't do that or they don't give you the tools to do that, you'll have to say, can you extract out the data into one nice neat table for me that I can then analyze? And then they might have to team you up with a MIS major or something like that to go in. They'll write the query to pull the data out of the database, and they say, here's your nice neat little table, all with just the data that you need for it. So I was your MIS major. I was your IT department that extracted the data out of the underlying database for this homework assignment that you just worked on. So I gave you the one flattened, they call it a flat file, one flattened table that contained all the data that you needed. But in reality, the data started out in an Access database with all these different tables in it. So we have a list of customers. So if you open up the customers, here's the customer people. Here's John's birth date, email address, yearly income, total children, number of children at home, bachelor, number of cars. So everything about a customer is in the customer table. Everything about a geography, city, state, zip code, country, two-digit country abbreviation. Everything about a product is in the product table. Everything about a product category, bikes, components, clothing, accessories, is in that table. Everything about the subcategories is in a subcategory table. Everything about a territory group, Pacific, has Australia, North America has Canada, United States, with these different regions in it. So everything about a subject is usually in a separate table. So here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 tables. And all the data from that previous data set is scattered about in these 7 tables. This is more often the case when somebody asks you to pull data out of the database. It's in this format. It's in a bunch of different tables. And you can go up to database tools and say, hey, well, show me the relationships between those tables. And here we have, when we talk about a relational database, they call it relational because the tables relate to each other. So for instance, we have a product category with a little one next to it, meaning one product category is related to many different subcategories. See the little infinity sign here. One subcategory has many products in it. See the one to the many. A product, one to many, product can be included on many different sales. That makes sense. Hopefully we'd sell more than one of a particular product. A customer has many internet sales, one to many. So these one to many's kind of help you determine the relationship of the different tables. So that's how the structure of the underlying relational database is. And we look at the actual file. It's 49 megabytes in size. 49 megabytes is not really that big of a database. You'll be confronted out in the working in the databases that are megabytes, gigabytes, terabytes in size. And if you try to access those databases directly with Excel, Excel, if we do it the way we did it on our homework, where we go out and we bring all the data into Excel, anything over a gigabyte in size in an Excel file, the file really starts slowing down. So if you have, if you're trying to bring in a gigabyte or 10 gigabytes of data into Excel, it really slows down in the old traditional way of doing things, which is the way I showed you before. PowerPivot allows us to go out and talk to the database and just bring in a kind of a ghost shrunken compressed image of that data. So if I create a new Excel file here, and I want to talk to that underlying database using a tool called PowerPivot, I have to turn it on because it's not up here. So I go up to File, Options. In Excel 2013, Microsoft just added PowerPivot as an add-in. You don't have to go download anything. So here's a PowerPivot. It's a COM add-in. It's inactive, so I have to turn it on. So I have to come up here and say COM add-ins, go. Turn on PowerPivot, hit OK. Now I have this PowerPivot tool. So I want to go in and say Manage. Probably working for the first time on this machine. Might take a minute. There we go. Let me go out and get the external data from a database, from Access, Browse. There's this PowerPivot from Access database that I was playing with before. And if there's a password required to log onto the database, you enter that here. And you can test the connection to make sure that you've got a working pipeline into the database. Click on that. Goes out and shakes hand with it. Yay, succeeded. So we now have an open connection to the database. And I can come in here and say, select a list of tables and views to choose the data to import. Now, if I want to bring all of the data in from all the tables, I can just click on all. Maybe I want just the data from North America. Let me see. Let me go to the territory. I want to look at that and preview and filter that. So I want, here's North America, Europe, Europe, Pacific, Europe. So I just want everything from North America. So I can just click on this little filter and say, just give me North America from this table. And now I'm just going to have those regions. Well, maybe I don't want Canada. Yeah, I'll leave Canada in. What the heck? Hit OK. And now I'm going to import by hitting Finish. And it's going to go out and import all the data from that Access database. Import, import, progress, 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 progress. Preparing it. In progress. Completed. Yay. Close. So now if you look here, I've got all the data from those seven tables of the Access database imported here into Excel. And now if I want to analyze those, I can come up here to pivot table. And here I can have a pivot table, a pivot chart, a chart and a table, horizontal chart and table, vertical, two charts, horizontal, vertical, or four charts, or just a flattened pivot table. Let's do a chart and a table horizontal. So this looks pretty familiar to what we had before. Here we have a chart, here we have a table, except instead of all of the little columns just all just showing up over here, I really have the seven tables. So I need to know what data points, what columns of data are in which tables. You all wouldn't know that, but I know where they all are, so I won't. I know that the sales total is down here in the fact internet sales. And if I can come down here, sales amount, and drag that down, there's that 29 million that we had before, right? And then if I want to analyze that by geography, I can come over here, let's do it by country, and show in rows. So remember, I filtered out all the other countries besides United States and Canada. I just excluded those when I filtered the data on the way in. So now I have the sales by country over here. So all the same pivot table stuff that I did before works just like it does here, so I'm not going to beat that. But let's, one thing you'll notice here is as I change the pivot table, the chart does not change. So I can actually come up with a different chart. Let's say I want sales amount. And I want my product category. So I can have the chart and the table show two completely different things here in PowerPivot. Remember on the regular power or the pivot table, as you changed one, the other changed. Here you've got two separate ones. So it's a little more powerful way of generating the tools you need for presentations or whatever you're looking for. One other powerful thing that you can do in PowerPivot, a lot of times the data that you need to display to your audience isn't even in the database. So for instance, here we have the internet sales table. Let's see here. We go out here to the right. We see that we have a unit price. How much are we selling it for? How much is the cost of that item? Or we're selling it for $4.99, a sales amount. It costs us $1.86. Well, how much profit do we make per item? That's not in the table. So if we were wanting to do a bunch of formulations and calculations and charts and stuff based on the profit or profitability of a given item, we can't do it because that profitability is not in any of these tables. In PowerPivot, however, you're able to create your own columns, and the values in those columns can be based on math. So if I come out here to the right, we now have this cool thing called add column. And I can just, in here, I can just type equals bracket. Let's see, I want the sales amount minus the product standard cost. And if I hit enter, it then goes and calculates all the values for all the rows of the table automatically. Takes a second to do. And there's the calculated column one, it's called. I can rename that to gross profit. And now if I go back to my pivot table and go to the fact internet sales and go to the bottom, there's your gross profit. It's now there where it wasn't there before. And I could, instead of the sum of the sales, I could drag the gross profit on there instead. And now I've got a list of the chartability of the profits. Let me save this and show you one other thing. I'm going to put it on my desktop. Power Pivot Output Save. And I want to close it. And here's that file that I just generated. Look at the file size out here. It's 5 megabytes. The underlying database that it's pulling the data out of is 50 megabytes. So it took all that 50 megabytes of data and put it into an Excel file. Even with a pivot table and a couple charts and a bunch of other stuff, it's still a fraction of the size. So this Excel file could talk to terabytes of data, and it wouldn't be so big that it would swallow up all the memory and run slowly. This PowerPivot allows Excel to talk to data sets of literally any size. And that's one of the reasons that Microsoft has put so much time and effort into Excel. They're using it as the interface to talk to data sets of all sizes, of all flavors, of any type. So, that being said, I think that's the end of this chapter, so you're free to go. I'll see you online for Chapter 8.